Hello, everybody. Welcome to Newsflash 501. We hope you enjoyed our last episode. It was quite a fun one to produce, but we were very, very sad we did not get to have James Stanley on with us. That all changes right now. He is here with us today to talk about very many important things, including some of the takeaways from the second day of the Derek Chauvin trial, what went on, and especially some of the young witnesses, the people whose lives were impacted by just being there and seeing that awful event happening in such a profound way. Also, we'll give you the latest on the COVID-19 process, from the vaccination to the variants, and everything that you need to know. Also, an incredible story. Matt Gaetz is said to face Justice Department inquiry over sex with an underage girl. That's the headline that just came out hours ago. The top Trump defender in the House of Representatives now facing a Justice Department investigation for pedophilia. Who would have seen that one coming, especially after all his kind of QAnon adjacent political behavior? So, meanwhile, though, we have to end it with a two-parter here on the Amazon union drive. What a story it's been. And we'll start with what you would expect. An article in Wired about that is both sides are preparing for a potentially protracted battle over ballots and labor practices as these results trickle in. And meanwhile, a new report by Ken Klippenstein showing how Amazon's Twitter army was handpicked for a great sense of humor. Leaked documents reveal those people you've been seeing on Twitter, if you're on Twitter, they are hand-trained to defend the Amazon brand in the interwebs. And James, thank you so much for joining us. We are going to really get into a lot of interesting topics today. And yeah, really appreciate you coming on.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
All right, so yeah, what do you think about this here? We got the second day of the Derek Chauvin trial underway here. The former Minneapolis police officer who was accused of killing George Floyd was marked by emotional testimony from witnesses who recounted what they saw and how it left them feeling traumatized. And this is kind of an incredible account of six people testifying in all, including four witnesses who are younger than 18 on the day of Floyd's arrest. These are all minors who really, I think the point was to see kind of take it from the perspective of these like young people whose lives were so traumatized by this brutal display of kind of police and state violence right in front of their own eyes in their own city. So what has been your reaction to this day and also James' trial in general?
Well, yeah, so far, I mean, this trial, I think, is really has come, like, I think that this trial is in and of itself a very riveting trial to have watched. And today's trial was one that I think was really powerful. I think that the witnesses were astounding, even, you know, given their age, some of which, as you previously mentioned, were incredibly young. The accounts and what they had to witness that day, you know, is something that I could never even imagine. But today's case and the hearing that occurred, I think, was fabulous. I think so far this case is going well, but I am, you know, not keeping my hopes up because, as we both know, typically, at least, you know, historically, it seems as if nothing ever actually happens. But I am feeling a little better about this case and other cases if I had to compare them. But so far, I'm very pleased to see so far how the trial has gone.
What is your sense about, like, the legal hill to climb that these people have, like the people who are trying to put Derek Chauvin behind bars, the prosecution here? What do they have to prove to get this, I believe now, like second-degree murder charge to stick?
I mean, in my personal opinion, I think they already proved it plenty. I think the video in and of itself is enough evidence, but given the fact that historically it seems as if there's there's a sizable bias given to these type of cases. It's almost as if I think the accounts and the witnesses is what really was needed. And I think that the witnesses that they called to the trial today were very strong. I think they most likely probably have even more that they're going to be calling. Maybe that was the end of the witness part for them. But I mean, even if it was, they had astonishing witnesses today. They were really well-versed and they went up there and they really, in my opinion at least, did a very, very respectable job in regards to discussing what actually had occurred that day. Because in my opinion, I don't know if I would even be able to do that because, even when I think about it to this day, it gets me very upset to think about what happened to George Floyd. But overall, I think that this case, in my personal opinion, I think they've already shown enough. But given the fact of the bias, I think that the witnesses were definitely something that they had to do. And I think, in my personal opinion, I think they really hit out of the park.
Yeah, so pretty much what prosecutors did here is they walked through the minute-by-minute arrest with witnesses. The youngest of them testified off-camera, though viewers could hear their voices in real time. At times, their voices wavered as they recalled the events of May 25th, and the attorneys gave them time between questions to collect themselves. So some of the highlights of the day include the testimony of young witnesses, including the grief and anger felt so profoundly by people across the country in the days after Floyd's death. Their presence made another point as well. These people have become victims themselves. The trauma of seeing a man lose consciousness while they could do nothing to stop it clearly left its mark, as evidenced by their tears as they testified. The young witnesses, this again here reporting, by the way, I should say, from the New York Times and Will Wright, the youngest witnesses told consistent versions of what they saw, and they all said they believed at the same time that something was going horribly wrong, saying, "I almost walked away at first because it was a lot to watch," said one witness who was a high school senior whose full name was not given in court. But I knew that it was wrong, and I could not walk away, even though I couldn't do anything about it. And that's really just quite an incredibly disturbing display of just seeing something right in front of your face and knowing it's wrong, but also it's at the same time it's the police. It's the government doing it. These people have so much power, and depending on your background, you have like various opinions of them. But to see that like flagrant display of police power and like so much unaccountable, like the fact that they can do that's one thing. Anyone can, you know, do something bad to a person, but if they're able to get away with it and they're protected by the government explicitly, that I think really opens up a whole another avenue of just chaosness and just rot and decrepitation in our society. What do you think about that dynamic at play?
Well, I think I personally agree with what you just stated. I think that when that is in play in our society, which in my opinion I think it is, I think it almost makes the police think that they have this type of barrier of protection against any type of harm or misconduct that they do in their job. You know, they are in a job, in my opinion, that is incredibly has a high responsibility, and it's almost as if many of the cops who have, you know, done things that are, well, first off, would otherwise be illegal for, you know, other people. I mean, you can't just sit on some guy's knee and then get away with it practically. I think that it's like the barrier of protection that they feel, because they know that if they do it, they could just use the thing like, oh, it was for self-defense, as they always do. I mean, that was clearly not in that circumstance for George Floyd, but they always use that it's always for self-defense. They every time it's the same card that's pulled out of the box. They never have any other type of excuse, and I think that the reason as to why they always pull that same card is because they have this feeling that they are kind of protected, and even if they did something wrong that is clearly illegal, they have this sense, at least, that they'll be protected by the system, and the system in it of itself is meant to be there to protect the cops, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, and it really is. Like, that is a system that's put in place, like, for the police, almost, like, by police and people who are very much associated with them ideologically anyway. Probably the most emotionally jarring testimony came from Darnella Frazier, who took a video of the arrest that helped ignite protests across the country. She was the one that everyone saw. Frazier expressed regret for not physically confronting Chauvin. I mean, as I saw it, that was like the thing. I was like, can't you just like get push the cop away? Like, I know it's an incredibly traumatizing situation, and of course, I want to say, I'm not trying to imply that I would have done anything different there, because like, of course not. Like, you can't even ever begin to put yourself in that situation, but it really like was the kind of first instinct, that your primal instincts that you have, just like, this is a horrible thing. And, you know, he and she felt that too, which is really kind of you can only imagine like the kind of agonizing, just however rational it is, the guilt that you have. She said, quote, "It's been nights I've stayed up apologizing and apologizing to George Floyd for not doing more and not physically interacting and not saving his life, said Frazier, adding that she had often reflected on the similarities of her black family members and Mr. Floyd. She worries for their safety and her own. I look at how that could have been each one of them. And that's probably a thought you got to imagine. This really exposes, I think, what the reality is for so many like black people all across this country, whether it's like big cities, small towns. Like, there are people out there who can just really do that and do it right in front of your face. And I think the part of that, like, where it's just such a flagrant, right in front of your face, display of power, and there's nothing like black families or any family victimized by the police can really do to stop it. It's such a powerful and overwhelming and scary thing that we could let loose into American society.
Yeah, I mean, I would probably agree with that. I think I think that the main problem that I at least have been able to notice is like the power of changing like a little bit, but staying with the topic of the police, like even like the PBA of many police departments, they are incredibly powerful. I mean, I remember that when AOC had came out and said, oh, look at the NYC PBA endorsing Trump, like look at how bad that is. I mean, and then people came out and said, oh, look at the teachers unions, like they're endorsing all the Democrats. The fact of the matter is, the PBAs of the country, in my opinion at least, have much more power, or at least have yielded much more of their power given than the teachers' unions to sway policies in our country. You know, you look at policies, for example, the policy, I believe, I'm sure, I think, oh, it was, I'm trying to remember the city, they were looking at possibly taking funds away from the police department, and then the governor. And the governor had said, oh, if you do this, you know, I'm not going to give you guys any state funding for your social programs and your schools that, you know, you guys are, you know, continuously requesting. I'm blanking on the state here. And it was later found out that the governor did that because of the fact that the PBA of the police department there had said that, like, they would.
Was it a Republican governor?
Yes, I will actually. I believe it was. I would have to go. I wouldn't really be that shocked if it was a Democrat.
I think
it was a Republican. To be honest with you, though, I think because I remember it being like an urban city, though, and like I think it was Georgia. That's the state it was. Yes, because it was the mayor. I forgot her name actually already. Alicia Bottoms, I think.
Yeah, Atlanta.
Yeah. She had said that, and Brian Kemp had then said, like, we're going to – they actually, I think, ended up passing that bill where if you defund the police, it's like a weird acronym they have. It's like defund the police, defund the city or something like that. That's basically like what it does is if you defund the city – I mean, excuse me, let's say the police, they're going to defund the city. Like, so if I defund the police by 20%, you know, if it's like $4 billion, I don't know. Just make a number out of here. That whatever percentage of the police budget that you defund, that's how much – the state will retract from state funding for the city. That was what was in the bill. There's also many other aspects, but that was like one of the
main
aspects.
so like stupid and so counterproductive, because the whole point of taking away from the police is to put more into social programs. So if you cut from the police, and that's the whole point. That's the point that activists make. It's like you're standing right. You're doing really literally the worst of both worlds there. But it really is a very kind of telling situation of how like far away we are in some parts of the country, and really in all parts of the country, because a lot of this stuff just has not been properly like put into policy yet by any stretch of imagination. So Chauvin's attorney, Eric Nelson, had a testy exchange with a mixed martial arts fighter who was at the scene of the arrest and testified on Monday and Tuesday. On Tuesday, Nelson argued that the witness, Donald Williams II, did not have enough medical or police training experience to analyze Floyd's cause of death. Previously, Williams had testified the placement of Chauvin's knee could have caused Floyd to suffocate. The defense also highlighted the loud crowd that formed on the sidewalk and yelled at the police officer during the arrest. Williams pushed back on the attorney's description of that, saying, "You can't paint me out to be angry." So that's kind of the interesting thing there. And if you look at what this guy's trying to do, like the excuses from the police officer, like, "Oh, it's too loud. We can't even do the job properly because there's too many people." Like, what? Like, come on, that's just absolutely ridiculous. Police just get way too much, you know, benefit of the doubt to assume that their job's so hard. We act like their job is, like, you know, harder than and so dangerous. Like, they risk their lives. Like, 99.9% of police, really, in terms of fatality rate, they have a much easier job than people realize, I think. Prosecutors continue to focus on how long Chauvin kept his knee on Floyd, pinning him to the street. While the defense may argue the use of force was necessary, prosecutors want to convince the jury the amount of time was unreasonable and unlawful. Even if the defense can effectively argue the force was necessary at first, prosecutors want to show that Chauvin kept Mr. Floyd pinned even after he lost his consciousness. Genevieve Hansen, a Minneapolis firefighter and emergency medical technician, also gave emotional tears, wiping tears from her eyes when she recalled witnessing the arrest. Hansen had urged police officers to take Floyd's pulse. She also called 911 at the time, making her the third witness to call the police on the police. So, kind of remarkable stuff there. But it really is interesting. It really is interesting to see that we have this kind of dynamic playing out where, like, all these people kind of associated with law enforcement in some way, coming out and saying, wait, we see there's a problem, we want to call law enforcement here, but law enforcement's the one committing the crime. There was a off-duty paramedic, I believe, who was in the crowd trying to come up and, like, help me, I'm a nurse, and the police would not let her through because, why would they? Because they were the ones who were committing the crime. Like, in this situation, they're functionally no different than criminals because they're out there putting their knee to this guy in the head, on their knee on this guy's neck and stopping people and but the system all around them was trying to, or not the system actually, no, the system I should say, was trying to help these people and still is trying to help these people. Every lever in the system is set up to help these people, but the people, like the relatively good people who are inhabit some of these parts, whether it be people. Only mostly you notice there are very few people actually in the police department, but people kind of around it in paramedic roles and dispatching roles. Like, they're like, oh my gosh, there's a huge problem. We need to stop and save it. But the police in the system were the people who are like, no, like we cannot abide by this. Yeah, really just a remarkable situation. What do you see happening here? Any final thoughts on this matter here with the Derek Chauvin trial?
I mean, one thing I will say is that I hope that something good actually comes out of this case. I think that it is very long overdue. And I feel relatively confident that something will positively occur from this case. But I'm also keeping my reservations to the side, just, you know, because given the past with these type of cases, I mean, Eric Garner was a prime time example. I mean, they had videographic evidence as well, and look what happened with that. It was thrown out and the guys are put onto death duty. So, but in regards to this case, I do feel a little bit more confident than I would have if the witnesses and the evidence provided to the case were not nearly as strong as they were.
Yeah, I really do think that's going to be a very, very important story to watch here. And just like, I really think that this guy cannot, by any circumstance, by any normal circumstances, get off here in any way. It just, and have this be a society like worth respecting. Like, what is the point of having laws or police whatsoever if this guy can kind of walk without a murder charge sticking to him here? Like, very, very insane. All right, we're going to take a 1-minute break. SWRN has so much going on to tell you about. We, of course, have to start with Newsflash. We continue to make the grind to our 500th episode. That'll be on Sunday the 28th with a big panel special bringing back some of your favorite Newsflash contributors. Until then, we'll be on the air, as always, every Sunday, Tuesday, and Thursday with that show. We start up our supplementary programming with a special all-new redesign edition of Uncultured Design to highlight some of the most interesting parts of hip-hop, whether it be past or present. And, of course, we are working on that brand new season of Hidden History, continuing telling the stories we told in Season 1. Spencer Walsh Radio Network. Listen today on Spreaker.com/TSWS. All right, so ladies and gentlemen, we are continuing to follow this thing called COVID. It's still around. It's hanging in there despite what some people may be doing over this this week. And I hate, you know, it's kind of very conflicting because I hate to be the person who's like shames people for going out because I just feel so annoying to me, like just instinctually. Although I know the right thing to do is, you know, you stay home for and be like relatively safe and cautious. But yeah, people are just like, you know, everyone's social media is at least in the high school level, is getting slightly more annoying than usual this week. But anyway, there is some good news here as we see some progress for COVID-19 vaccinations rapidly expanding to all adults in many states over the next month. A new poll shows a continuing increase in number of Americans, particularly black adults, who want to get vaccinated. But it also found the vaccine skepticism remains stubbornly persistent, particularly among Republicans and white evangelical Christians, an issue that the Biden administration has flagged as an impediment to achieving herd immunity and return to normal life. I mean, honestly, these people who really, it's kind of very unfortunate because these have been the people holding us up in large part to return to normal life. These oftentimes, you know, very, and I'm talking about not the people, because there's a lot of people who aren't able to, you know, stay home or like self-isolate because they can't financially, but a lot of times these like richer evangelical Christians, like the people who own, you know, boats and pickup trucks in maybe a red state, but think they're like working class hardscrabble guys because they have pickup trucks and all those things like that. But they really, you know, they can't leave the, like air conditioning for 5 minutes in the summer. These are the same type of people who are kind of like, I would guess are going to be people who are less likely to get the vaccine. Even though they have been proved with, like, there's people, for example, black adults have a lot of good reason to distrust the government. But if you're talking about white Republicans and Christians, like, those people are not people who are very susceptible to, like, reason and, like, you know, logical thinking patterns. What is your reaction to some of this news, James?
I mean, it is, well, for the evangelical Christian, I would agree with the rather subjective description of them. I think the main aspect, though, of it, because I was actually reading an article a couple weeks ago about this, I know they use aborted fetuses through stem cell research and also some proteins from aborted fetuses in some of the vaccine research, supposedly.
Oh, is it all the vaccines or just?
No, I mean, it was like, I mean, honestly, everything, technically almost every medication vaccine has been used through stem cell research. So technically, I mean, if they're really that like crazed about like, oh, no, you know, no abortion, no using any type of aborted fetuses, then they shouldn't even really be using medication. But I mean, we both know that they probably are using some type of medication. But no, it's not. I don't believe it's in the vaccine necessarily. I know that the research, though, did have aspects of using stem cell research from aborted fetuses. But I think it's also just because of the fact that they are, in my opinion, brainwashed to just believe everything Trump says, many of these groups. I'm not saying evangelical Christians necessarily. I'm saying more so the people who have not been open to getting the virus. And the reason I say that is because he never specifically said to get the virus in many open fashions. I mean, he doubted COVID was even a real thing until, I don't think ever, actually, to be quite frank with you. I mean, even the debate, he was like, oh, it's almost done. But like, we're here now, like, what, 6 months later, and the thing is still here with us, which, you know, wasn't shocking whatsoever. And on top of that, he wants to take credit for the vaccine, which, look, yeah, he was president. But the fact of the matter is he did nothing in regards to getting the vaccine. The scientists who had made the first vaccine, which was, I believe, through Pfizer, if I'm correct, weren't even – their research was not funded whatsoever by the American government. It was funded by multiple European nations and Japan. One of the scientists, I believe, was from Turkey, and the other one, I believe – I forgot actually where he was from, so I'm not going to lie and just say a random country. And I know for a fact that before he left office, I know that he said a lot of things like, oh, Biden's going to make like any vaccines hard, this and that. And the other thing as well is I think that a lot of the people who were brainwashed by Trump just don't really trust Biden because, well, Trump did say a lot of BS about Biden being like a Chinese spy and this all, all the crap that he kept on spewing out the entire election about even him being like a socialist, which was quite laughable, to be honest with you, because we both know that he is nowhere near a progressive or even a socialist for that matter. But anyhow, getting back to the topic at hand, I think the main aspect of it is just that they're brainwashed by Trump and they haven't actually even heard him say specifically, it's time for everyone to get the vaccine. I mean, he wasn't included in the TV ad, with the other presidents, which I don't really think has an impact anyway. But at the same time, not having him in public life, via Twitter, etc., definitely, I think, did have an effect. And I think people just don't trust anything right now. If, Biden is in charge, for example, I think literally, like, they probably don't trust anything. They probably don't trust the school system. They probably don't trust anyone on TV. They probably don't trust anyone. I mean, I don't know what goes through the people's mind, but that's just my hypothesis for the situation at hand.
Yeah, like it is a pretty incredible response that we've seen from kind of various points, but with the future of the variant, we're looking at some of the cases here. They, at least in the United States, like pretty much the scariest area has been in kind of continental Europe, and in some ways you could argue because they kind of slowed up with the vaccine, but they have been starting to go up plus 18% over 14 days, and they're like deaths are down, but they're probably going to go up in the future. This, of course, with the battle of the variants and the vaccines, what do you see happening here, and like how will those play out, at least in the United States? Like, what is the are we under threat at this point? Was the CDC director who came out and recently said we're in a little bit of trouble, was she said she was scared, I think that was the word. Was she right to say that?
I mean, I don't, I would say that she is correct to say that, given the fact that, look, this virus has many, I mean, every virus has many paths that it can go down for mutations. Thankfully, for now, many of the mutations that have been, founded have been protected still, from our vaccines that we've had for a couple months now. I think what they're more worried about is, given the fact that the vaccine, not vaccine, excuse me, that the virus is mutating at such a fast rate, that it will mutate around the vaccine, which will make it would make it very bad if that happens, because at that point, then almost all of the work with vaccinations would go right out the window. And that kind of goes back to the whole thing of why we kind of need to follow what has been put out with taking necessary precautions, because the only reason why this virus is mutating is because there are certain groups of people who are still not taking the necessary precautions to allow it. A virus mutates only when it is, well, reproducing, and the only way that this virus reproduces and expands and spreads is by human contact and obviously internal spreading, But if one person has a mutation and they protect, they use a mask, etc., they're less likely to spread it to other people. But if someone who doesn't do those type of things, it will spread much quicker. And so, given the fact that Europe, for example, they relaxed a lot of their restrictions a couple of months ago, almost to the point where they were almost fully reopened, actually. It was actually quite crazy how close they got to fully reopening. Now they're back into shutdown mode, at least many of the countries are, because of the mutations and the slow vaccinations that they've been having over there. But overall, I definitely would be. I think the CDC director is right. I think that there is a little bit of a warranted sense of worrying, given the fact that we don't know what the mutation may do next, or what new mutation may come next, is what I should really say. And if that mutation does in fact get around the vaccine, what is our plan B? Because if that happens, then, well, we gotta change the vaccine formula, and then what's that gonna mean for people who got fully vaccinated or are currently getting vaccinated right now? So maybe we have to start all over again, because if that is the case, then that's gonna be real, really, really big problem, I think.
Yeah, that's definitely going to be very, very worrying. Coming up next, we have a very big and kind of shocking story for you.
Just it. Just it. Just it. Just it.
Matt Gaetz, the crazy Trump congressman from Florida, is under investigation with the Justice Department. I don't, this music, playing this music in the background, is wholly inappropriate at the moment, but I didn't mean for it to turn out that way. But there we are. We have a kind of crazy situation. There's already come out of reports that he wasn't going to seek a second term anyway. It was going to go over to Newsmax. But it may be a little bit tough for Newsmax to hire now a accused pedo. So Matt Gaetz, pretty much a close ally of former President Donald Trump, a Republican representative from Florida, being investigated by the Justice Department over whether he had sexual relationship with a 17-year-old and paid for her to travel with him, according to three people briefed on the matter. Yeah, so what's your reaction to the story right off of the gate? And you know, there's a certain amount of projection here with how much he's talked about QAnon. That's for sure. He kind of been in that area.
Yeah, well, I think it is quite crazy. But at the same time, I mean, he was a very, very crazy figure. I, in all honesty, am not 100% shocked that this happened with him. I mean, he always had this very strange vibe to him whenever he was talking about anything in regards to politics. I mean, he was just a brainwashed Trump lackey in the House. And him and Jim Jordan are both people who, in my opinion, are very, let's just say this in a nice way, retarded. In the sense, I say that because both of them are just, they say things that literally, if you had a couple of brain cells, you would literally realize that they like are completely false. Many of the things they say are wrong. Matt Gaetz in and of himself is, in my opinion, I think that he is an egomaniac. I think that he clearly has been doing many of the things he does because he realizes that the Republican Party is the party of Trump, or as I call the CTOP, Conspiracy Theory Operative Party, part of the QAnon LLC. And he realizes that, and so he wants to use their popularity, QAnon and Trump, you know, I'm talking about right now, as a means for him to elevate himself and his own image. And at the same time, people who are power hungry will do things that at many times are immoral. Trump did it. So did someone like, you know, Jeffrey Epstein, for example. They were both those men, for example, were incredibly powerful. Matt Gaetz is incredibly powerful. And these allegations, I am not 100%, I personally not 100% shocked that they actually had come out, because he's always been a very, very, very strange figure in the House, in my opinion. I think he's never really been a very intelligent figure in the House. I think he says a lot of things that, and quite frankly, he doesn't even know what he's saying half the time. But again, going back to what I literally just said, I think that he does it because of the fact that he realizes and recognizes that the only way in which he's going to gain his power in the Republican Party and his own self-image is by lying and by doing things that are otherwise considered incredibly wrong and many times offensive things to do. And on top of that, even looking at his past, I believe he was the representative who had a drunk driving arrest. Am I correct? Say that.
Yeah, and he also has a very weird history with his, of course, his son, his adopted son, who is like 19 and he's like, what, something like 30? Something. I don't know how old he is, Matt Gaetz, but like I believe, yeah, his son's name is Nestor, and technically, like, he still has a dad who's alive and did not put him up for adoption, and like nothing's wrong with him. And yeah, Matt Gaetz is just walking around conservative media being like, guys, don't you love me and my adopted son? Like, how normal is this? It is very, very strange to see, like, so like people like that. And another person who's kind of similar to that was like Jerry Falwell, but you know, obviously, do you have to say allegedly here, because it isn't just an investigation, and it could very well be that this just turns out to be nothing. So we do want to kind of cover our bases with that, but you know, it's really not like what, probably I would say without a doubt one of the creepiest people in politics, just in terms of at least public appearance. And what the way he presents himself in public. So investigators are examining whether Gaetz violated federal sex trafficking laws. Some people said there's very, very serious allegations here. A variety of federal statutes make it illegal to induce someone under 18 to travel over state lines to engage in sex in exchange for money or something of value. The Justice Department regularly prosecutes such cases, and the offenders do receive pretty severe sentences. It's not clear how Matt Gaetz met this girl, believed to be 17 at the time of their encounter about 2 years ago. But the investigators are scrutinizing, according to the people. The investigation was first opened in the final months of the Trump administration under William Barr, two people said. Given Gates' national profile, senior Justice Department officials in Washington, including some appointed by Trump, were notified of the investigation, people said. So let's see how many sources this is. Three people briefed on the matter here. So not the best sourcing, but it'll be interesting to see. I believe there's been... But we don't have to even have to worry about it. We know there's definitely an investigation because Matt Gaetz pretty much came out and he came out to Tucker Carlson and said it literally that there's an investigation going on. So there definitely is one going on. He didn't really do a particularly good job of defending himself there. So James, how legit does this story here seem to you off the bat?
I personally think that it is. We're talking about the Matt Gaetz thing, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that it is correct, factual. I think that I really wouldn't deny that it happened. I mean, I think that it did because, this again, he has an incredibly odd record, in the House, number one, and also just life overall. I mean, he's just a very weird guy. And I think I think it connects back to the point I made earlier. He's clearly a power-hungry individual. I mean, I think that you notice that with when he goes onto the floor, at least when he goes on the floor and he's literally like the Trump spokesman for free there. Same thing with, I mean, I think a lot of the Republicans do that as well. I don't think it's just him necessarily, but it's clearly Matt Gaetz and Jim Jordan overall are just two weird people that they clearly go together. And I mean, number one, you can see that they go together because they're always together on these type of crazy things for Trump. Number two, they're both very weird people, but you're talking more about Matt Gaetz here.
Yeah, and they both have weird sexual connections as well.
Yeah, I mean, the Ohio, the OSU sexual
assault.
Yeah,
a lot of liberals call him, like, Jim Jordan, spelled G-Y-M, because he, like, covered up for this, like kind of gropey doctor in Ohio State as a wrestling coach. Anyway, pretty much, like, the thing is, we have this is a great clip here. This is Matt Gaetz responding to sex trafficking allegations. Just a little clip of it on Tucker Carlson that I sent you, James. You won't be able to hear it, but you can go through and listen to it.
And I believe we are in an era of our politics now, Tucker, where people are smeared to try to take them out of the conversation. I'm not the only person on screen right now who's been falsely accused of a terrible sex act. You were accused of something that you did not do, and so you know what this feels like. You know the pain it can bring to your family, and you know how it just puts people on defense when you're accused
that.
Of something so salacious and awful. But it did not happen. It is not true. And I believe...
Yeah, like, that is... I think Tucker Carlson, I don't remember. So this is how he responded.
People are smeared to try to take them out of the conversation. I'm not the sort my family will release the tapes that they are in possession of. The American people will see what is really going on.
You just referred to a mentally ill viewer who accused me of a sex crime 20 years ago. And it was not true. I'd never met the person. But I do agree with you that being accused falsely is one of the worst things that can happen. And you,
yeah. And then Tucker Carlson, of course, reacted in a very kind of strange way afterward. Well, not actually a very normal way to the very strange presentation that took place after the interview with this right off of the bat.
If you just saw our Matt Gaetz interview, that was...
Wait, there we go. We got to unmute there. That would be the key, he says.
If you just saw our Matt Gaetz interview, that was...
Oh, my gosh. I am not doing so well with the computer today. I apologize.
That was one of the weirdest interviews I've ever conducted. That story just appeared in the news a couple of hours ago. And on the certainty that there's always more than you read in the newspaper, we immediately called Matt Gaetz and asked him to come on and tell us more. Which, as you saw, he did. I don't think that clarified much, but it certainly showed this is a deeply interesting story, and we'll be following it.
Yeah, so very, very bad look when you can't get Tucker Carlson on your side here. Whatever doubts I may have had about, like, you know, a kind of a crazy story about this, you know, I really should put him, like, down the window because this is very, very clearly a serious investigation. The three people that said the examination of Gaetz is part of a broader investigation into a political ally, a local official in Florida named Joel Greenberg, who was indicted last summer on an array of charges, including sex trafficking of a child and financially supporting people in exchange for sex, at least one of whom was an underage girl. Greenberg, who has since resigned from his post as a tax collector in Seminole County, north of Orlando, visited the White House with Gates in 2019, according to a photograph that Greenberg posted on Twitter. Yeah, so a lot more interesting stuff could come of this and what's been going on in Florida. So his incredibly strange defense is he said in an interview his lawyers had been in touch with the Justice Department and that they were told he was the subject, not the target, of an investigation. I only know that it has to do with women. It's like, guys, trust me, it has to do with women here. We're talking about women. I have a suspicion that someone is trying to recategorize my generosity to my ex-girlfriends as something more than untoward. Gates said that the investigation is part of kind of an elaborate scheme involving false sex allegations to extort him and his family for $25 million that began this month. He said he and his father, Don Gates, who have been cooperating with the FBI and been wearing wires after they were approached by people who were saying they could make the investigation go away. And he said, it's verifiably false that I've traveled with a 17-year-old woman. So, kind of an incredible story there. We will keep following it, as I'm sure more news will come up. But, yeah, like, what are your kind of final thoughts about this this whole story and just kind of the broader reactions to this that we've seen so far?
I mean, I personally think that – now, you're referencing to the video still, right?
Yeah, whether it be the video, whether it be just the case in general.
Well, I mean, in my opinion, I think – well, first off, the video was quite interesting, I thought. I mean, I was watching it along when you showed the viewers. But, I mean, I think that he's clearly trying to sidetrack on everything. I mean – He was continuously bringing up Tucker in the video. He's continuously going on to Twitter and saying that it's a deep state, you know, making up the lies that they always have made. And it's always the same stuff. And I think in regards to the case, I think that I'm not really too shocked that it occurred. I don't know if did you see that it was actually started under Attorney General Barr. They at least started to inquire about it.
And
I think it's just in my personal opinion, I think it's kind of crazy to think that it was looked at for such a long time and it only became public now. Given what I have seen so far, though, about it, I definitely would not doubt that it would have happened. I mean, this whole thing with the 19-year-old son, or at least supposedly son, because it's not even like his legal son, like he doesn't have any paperwork whatsoever for the kid. So there's just a lot of things that this guy does in his life that are clearly really odd and questionable. And this case with the 17-year-old, for example, I mean, he's literally – I don't think he even realizes it, to be honest with you. This kind of goes back to the statement I made previously about where I think he's kind of a little dumb. He's saying that it's not illegal to put a young child on an airplane – and paying them, like, you know, funds. Like, why would you have to say that? Because if you didn't do it, then you don't have to defend yourself like that. Like, I think he literally kind of just gave it away that he did it and he doesn't think it's wrong. Obviously, he didn't say anything about the sex part, but I wouldn't really be too shocked if that actually
happened. Like, he said, oh, yeah, I didn't travel with a, like, girl, but, like, you know, did you meet a 17-year-old girl at any time? You know, very weird. Anyway, let's finish off today with some Amazon news. The campaign to unionize has been featured in nearly 5,300 stories by more than 2,000 reporters spanning the two dozen countries and six continents, according to Chelsea Connor, the very in-demand communication director for the Retail, Wholesale, and Department Store Union, which is vying to represent the workers. Today marks the end of the voting phase. The warehouse's 5,800 eligible workers have until the end of the day to get these Amazon union ballots in, vote union yes or no, into the hands of National Labor Relations Board officials. Then all eyes turn to the board's Birmingham office, where starting Today, the NLRB staffers will begin tallying up the votes. For the union to win, a majority of those votes need to be yes. And we're not, it's not going to be like the election where they're going to like release the result real quick. Even if half of these eligible workers return the ballots, it could take days for the boards to finish the tally. And you can really argue that there's going to be a lot of more than just half of the people returning their ballots. The NLRB representatives will conduct a hand count in front of observers from both sides, first extracting each ballot from its signed yellow envelope. As officials read off the names, both sides can and probably will issue challenges, either on procedural grounds, like things like unreadable signatures or by disputing workers' eligibility to vote. Challenge ballots will be set aside, and the remaining anonymized ballots, probably Amazon's going to be doing most of the challenging here, will be placed inside a ballot box for a public count. If after the count, the number of challenged ballots is enough to affect the outcome, that means more waiting. The regional board will hold a hearing to rule on the disputed votes, potentially adding weeks to the process. And the worst part of that all is it could get worse. After the tally, each side has 7 days to file objections to the way the election was conducted, including charges to the unfair labor practices, charges of unfair labor practices in an election that saw an unmarked ballot box of mysterious origin appear on company grounds, a website spreading misleading information about dues paying, and the timing change on a traffic light where organizers talk to workers. Some observers believe the RWDSU has ample grist for a ELP challenge or three against Amazon if things don't go their way in the count. A guilty verdict could overturn the result and trigger a whole do-over, which I'm sure the workers really would not want at this time. Outside of the election process, there's also the little-deployed option of suing the NLRB directly should either side believe the agency mishandled the election, which is rare, but this election has been anything but ordinary. And what do you think here? Well, first of all, let's just start with the basics. What has been your reaction to this kind of incredible story?
I think it's absolutely astonishing. I really am looking forward to hopefully seeing the Amazon workers in Alabama become unionized, because I think that is well deserved. I mean, Amazon in and of itself is a company that has made huge sums of money for the years. I think we've seen it in the pandemic where they have really gone on to the fast train ride here with increasing their profits and gaming the system for their favor. And in return, though, we notice that the workers of Amazon don't have, first of all, they don't have a union. Their pay is relatively low. Their working conditions are really not good. And I think that this unionization, that vote that occurred, I think that if it actually passed, I think it will give a new hope and a new light to unionization in America. We've seen over the last couple of years that unionization has gone down. Obviously, you know,
more than the last couple of years. It's been a very long time.
Yeah, I mean, I think it definitely has been a very long time. I think I meant to say, like, over the last couple of years, it has, like, exacerbated to the point where politicians are now starting to talk about, which, in all honesty, they probably should have been talking about it for years past, because, again, I mean, as you just mentioned before, it has been happening for many years. I think it was almost 30, 40 years ago that it started to happen, maybe even 50. But anyway, getting back to the point at hand, in my opinion, I 100% support their effort for unionization. I think that it is a great thing to do. But the second I think of unionization, I also think about what happened down in California with Prop 22. I hope and pray that that doesn't happen again. Because, look, I know for a fact that Amazon is going to try to do a proposition amongst – I forgot which state they were trying to – they were funding – I think they actually were funding Prop 22, if I'm correct, even though it didn't have anything to do with them. I remember that there was like a little bit of a leak in regards to Amazon funding certain commercials for it, because if that passed, which it ended up passing, it would have opened the door for them to find leeways and ways around California's strict rules, for example. But anyway, getting back to the topic at hand, if the people in Alabama unionize, I think that it will empower a lot more Amazon warehouse employees to do the same, which is why I'm 100% supportive of the initiative to unionize the employees in the Alabama plant. And if it passes, I really do hope that that happens. I do hope to see that the unionization will start to have a domino effect into other Amazon warehouses and overall across many spectrums. But that's just not, you know, it's we can't just rely upon that. We also need to have better regulations for labor laws, in my opinion. I think that unions probably should be a right, in my opinion. But I think, given the fact of what we see here with Amazon's anti-union propaganda that they force their employees to go to, by the way, which is, in my opinion, incredibly absurd, I'm hoping that that didn't really have an effect on the voters' opinions, the employees' opinions in their votes, which in all honesty, I really don't think it did. But the whole thing of them wanting to install a camera, there's a reason for that. They want to see who's voting for which way, for unionization or against unionization. It's more of intimidation. And I think Amazon gets a gold medal for that every year for workforce intimidation and incredibly harsh workforce environments. And
yeah, and I mean, honestly, some of the ways they do it are really kind of insane. Like, there's a new report by The Intercept here. Amazon's had a small Twitter army, which was quietly conceived in 2018 under the codename Veritas, which sought to train and dispatch select employees to social media trenches to defend Amazon and its CEO Jeff Bezos, according to an internal description of the program obtained exclusively by The Intercept. Amazon ambassadors drew attention this week as they responded to a wave of online criticism for the company's treatment of workers amid a union drive at an Amazon warehouse in Bessemer, Alabama. So this guy, Professor Cena, tweets out, "Hey, at Amazon, just want to say that I'm okay with getting the garbage I order from you a lot later if it means your employees are able to take adequate breaks and work with dignity." Just saying. Gary at Oak4 says, "My FC lets me take two," this is in parentheses there, "two 20-minute breaks and one 30-minute lunch. On overtime days," and this again, like in a 12-hour shift or something like that, "on overtime days, we get three 20-minute breaks, which is also pretty nice as well. Before the pandemic, our breaks usually used to be only 15 minutes. The overall 10-minute increase is thumbs up. Being an essential worker is dignifying for me." Like, it's so weird. And incredibly weird way of tweeting. Yola at Oak4 says, "Although the facility is big, there are numerous bathrooms to use. My building has 12. Each bathroom can have 3 to 6. That's plenty. Plus, with 20 or 30 minute breaks, that's more than enough time." So yeah, thank you there, Yola. "Anticipating criticisms of working conditions at their fulfillment centers, in particular, Amazon designed Veritas to train fulfillment center workers chosen for their great sense of humor to confront critics." So pretty much, who's willing to take the biggest pay raise to like debase themselves on social media, including policymakers on pretty much confronting critics, including policymakers on Twitter in a blunt manner. The document, produced as part of a pilot program in 2018 and marked Amazon.com confidential, includes examples of how its ambassadors can snarkily respond to criticisms of the company and the CEO. And I think the thing they realize here, like don't realize here, is that this stuff looks stupid and insane to anybody reading it from the outside. Like Yola at Oak4, if you're on Twitter at all in any way, and by the way, again, Amazon of all people, they're the most powerful company in the world. They should know of all things. Twitter isn't real life. But yeah, yet here they are doing this kind of ridiculous stuff. Like, do they actually think this stuff works? Like, is this their best attempt that we're seeing here, do you think? Or is it something that is like, you know, they're trying half-heartedly because they're Amazon and they don't really have to try that hard because they'll still get whatever they want without even trying?
I think that Amazon, I really think that it's almost like they're in their own world. But answering the question, I think that it seems as if that they hire these people solely so that people have a reason to believe them. I don't really believe Amazon whatsoever, but there are probably people who do believe what they say on Twitter and in their, you know, newsletters, etc.
I mean, probably not many. Like, this is just doesn't seem to be very convincing stuff. Like, they're not, like, the thing is, like, they just don't seem to be trying is because they're trying and they're like, this is the best they can muster, or do they not have to? Like, that's really, I think, the thing that we have to wait and see for.
I mean, it seems as if I would probably say that I don't really think they have to. I think people are still going to – I mean, it's clear that people are still going to use Amazon even given the horrible things that they do to their employees. And the justifications that they give, like, oh, like the bathroom one, for example, you just said, like, oh, we have like 6 bathrooms and, you know, 3 to 6 or – no, 12 bathrooms, you know, we give like 20, 30-minute breaks. I mean, it's – There's enough evidence to show that it's just not the case. There are many Amazon drivers.
And also, they can have as many bathrooms as they want, but if they don't let their employees use them, like, it doesn't do much good.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's perfectly said. I mean, it's even that. It's also like these supposed breaks. Many of the people who work for Amazon now, these are delivery men and some of the drivers are contractors. And they don't even work for Amazon. They work through contracts to contracted companies. And the problem with that is that, well, number one, they're forced to do much more work than an Amazon employee would do because they're given way too much work to do in a day. I mean, there have been many accidents involved with Amazon drivers because they literally have had to rush to get to everywhere because they have to deliver a certain amount of packages in a day that, you know, when you look at it from afar, it's absolutely absurd. But I honestly think that this whole thing of Amazon social media team, I think it's kind of similar to the I'm trying to remember here what company exactly it was. It was a company that, or I should name it a company actually. It was like PragerU. There you are, PragerU, with what they do. They're like, oh, like they like always like try to defend Trump, for example. Like whenever he would say something that was incredibly like, you know, wrong, they would go out and just start defending him with videos and saying, oh no, he's right. Here's why, like. It's this like defense mechanism that is like a very, in my opinion, toxic that Amazon has. I mean, look, they don't even recognize the reports in any of these, which obviously they probably wouldn't. But the one thing I will say is that there are multiple sources that show that what has been reported with Amazon, you know, with the no breaks, you know, peeing in the bottle, are incorrect, factually correct. But there have been many, if not more than, you know, dozens of lawsuits put up against Amazon for their worker intimidation, worker abuse, and in all honesty, low wages.
And a lot of the companies all across Amazon, like in Italy, for example, is unionized. In France is unionized. I believe maybe in England as well. But it's very interesting to see how like they're really going all out for this. And, like they're having a full corporate strategy, a full like we're going to put a presentation up on the Amazon conference room and really examine this stuff here. You can see them doing it. Kelly Nantle, an Amazon spokesperson, said via email, FC ambassadors are employees who work in our fulfillment centers and choose to share their personal experience. The FC ambassador program helps show the public really what it's like, along with public tours we provide. In 2018, Amazon admitted that ambassadors were employees paid to honestly share the facts, yet they're clearly paid. And, of course, if they're paid by Amazon, they have to be honest. Like, of course. Like, this is so, so silly. Many Twitter users had at first believed the ambassadors were automatic bot accounts due to their nearly identical format of their account bios, all of which feature the Amazon Smile logo and begin with the handle at Amazon FC. And they all pretty much joined months ago, or like last month or something like that. Or this month, like March 2021, but that format was specifically mandated by Amazon. The Intercept document shows we could all, like they really know how to make a person appeal relatable and appear credible online. Like this is all the like the, you have to imagine they spent all this money on like a consulting team to like produce a full comprehensive digital strategy, and they couldn't even figure out how to not make it look like bots. Like it's so funny. Yeah. It really insane stuff. We could also add an emoji to the username to give it personality. For example, a small box emoji. Like, that's literally what bots do. They just put a bunch of, like, useless emojis and numbers that don't mean anything. Like, no actual person puts, like, an emoji in their display name unless, like, you know, they're, like, trying to put like, prove a point or something like that. I don't even know.
Yeah, and on top of that, like, even the money that they're putting for these consulting companies, like, they could literally just put that into unionization. Like, the amount of money that Amazon does
for unionization busting, really, that's what they're really going to try to do.
Yeah, I mean, they could just – all the money that they put into that, the ludicrous stuff, they could literally just be putting in to the union benefits that they could just give to their employees, which is just – I mean, it's so expensive they got no money. But yeah. Obviously, we both know that this is not the case.
We can't pay them more. Oh, no. We can't afford them to take any time off. Like, yeah, like, it really is.
We're going to close down 20% of our houses. It's like the same BS they always say.
Yeah, it's really incredible. It's like to see, like, this is really kind of Amazon's a great representation of capitalism coming in at its, like, finest form. Like, there is never a point where you say enough is enough. There's never a point where you say, okay, let's take a step back here. This is, maybe we're going too far. We don't, like, we need to, like, it's always more, it's always increasing the revenue, expanding, expanding, expanding. And a lot of that comes at driving other people's lives, like the underclass, the working class, whether the people work for you or whether they work for the companies that you're putting out of business, driving them to misery. It's all for profit. It's all literally just to rend the souls and like the sap the lives, really, of these Amazon workers, just day in and day out. Because for people like Jeff Bezos and people really at the commanding heights of American capitalism, you know, enough is just not a word in their vocabulary. They don't know what it means. I think that's probably the biggest thing from this response to the unionization drive.
I would agree. I mean, I think that it's clear that Amazon is going to try and just keep their overly large power, and in order to just make themselves more powerful. I mean, they don't care about their employees. They clearly don't. They never will. And I really think at this point, the only way in which that's going to change, which I still don't even think that's going to change even with unionization, but the only way in which the employees can at least have a better experience is if this unionization in Alabama passes, and hopefully if it does, we see some type of domino effect. But most importantly, we should really be seeing action from Washington. Like, again, this kind of goes back to the whole thing of why I think, like, yeah, I think it's nice, the thing with doing Alabama, but we could do more. The government could definitely come in and say, first off, worker conditions. I mean, if they're supposedly peeing in a water bottle, that is incredibly wrong. If they're not having breaks, that's technically that they are breaking labor law by not giving the workers breaks. But then they have to have better enforcement. Like, the government can come in and swoop in. And the thing I don't really understand is why they haven't done that. Now, obviously, you know, with Biden, probably won't ever happen. But, you know, at the same time, we still can't keep our hopes down that it never will, because we really should try to get something passed. I think that the unionization effort is good, but I think we also should focus on
the PRO Act. So important there. All right. That is all the time we have for today. We are going to say so long. And this has been Newsflash. Thank you very much for listening.